Excellencies have gone. We must give up this excellency business. Honorable. Honorable Minister, Government of India, Sri Prakash Javadekarji, Honorable Sri Justice Chandramouli Kumar Prasadji, Chairman of the Press Council, Sri Jayashankar Guptaji, Convener, the jury for this award selection, Srimati Anupama Bhatnagar, Secretary Press Council of India, distinguished awardees who have been recognized today by the Press Council for their prestigious, meaningful and constructive contribution to the cause of journalism, media and the common good of the country. And members of the Press Council of India, friends from the media, brothers and sisters, I am extremely delighted to be amidst you all and share my views on the occasion of National Press Day, which symbolizes the important role played by a free and responsible press. Free and responsible press. It was on this day in 1966, the Press Council of India, a quasi-judicial body, started functioning as a watchdog body. I'm happy that several journalists in different areas are being honored for excellence in journalism today. My congratulations to all the winners. My dear sisters and brothers, ever since the launch of the first newspaper in India, the Bengal Gazette, by James Augustus Hickey in 1780, the press has been playing an outstanding role in empowering the people. The press played a pioneering and stellar role in inspiring the masses to fight against the British during the freedom struggle and in strengthening the democratic foundations in the country since independence. The nationalist role played by the newspapers and generals contributed in no small measure to influencing and molding the public opinion during the freedom struggle. However, during the emergency, barring few exceptions like the Indian Express, the Statesman, the mainstream and some more newspapers, the response of the Indian press by and large was muted during the emergency. The blank editorial published by the Indian Express during the emergency under the leadership of Sri Ramnath Goenkaji was perhaps one of the strongest protests ever published against censorship in India. It spoke more loudly than any words could have. When asked about his fight for the truth in the face of stiff resistance, Sri Ramnath Goenkaji was reported to have said, "I had two options, to listen to the dictates of my heart or my purse. I choose to listen to my heart." This is what he has said. I was just going through the letters written by Sri Ramnath Goenka. Just all I got this book a few days back, I think, by T.J.S. George, one of the noted journalists of our country. And the founding editorial of Indian Express, the inaugural issue of Indian Express, 5th September 1932, owing no allegiance to any existing political party in the country, it will stand staunchly for freedom in all national spheres of activity, non-communal in outlook. It will advocate justice to all communities in political, social, and economic life with a view to welding all of them into a great Indian nation. Welding all of them into a great Indian nation. That is also there. Freedom is to protect the people's right, to project the aspiration of the people. Freedom to criticize the government and its wrongdoings. Freedom to highlight the best practices followed by the people, and freedom ultimately to protect the interest of the nation. This has to be understood by one and all, because often we find we have freedom, we will do anything, we write anything. You have got every right to do anything. But the uppermost thing should be the country's interest. The national unity, integrity, safety, sovereignty of the people and the country should be uppermost in our mind. The media landscape has transformed dramatically over the years, and so have the values of journalism. In the past, journalism was treated as a mission. Why journalism? Even politics. Other professions like medicine, education. But of late, we are seeing some of them being converted from mission to commission. And many of them are doing omission and also giving remission to the truth, forgetting their own mission. It's high time that we remind the people, particularly people who are working in that profession, that this is a mission, a pious mission for the cause of the nation. Let us not do any omission. The men who wielded the pen were committed to ethics and higher standards of journalism. They used to work with undiminished enthusiasm and were overzealous in protecting its values. The topic chosen for discussion on National Press Day this year, reporting interpretation a journey, is quite appropriate. News used to be news in the past, and it was never neither interpreted nor misinterpreted. Now news and views are being clubbed together. That is the problem. They should be easily distinguishable. You have got every right to convey your views, but first you must all convey the news, and then separately write, add your views, and people are the ultimate judges to come to conclusion. Occasionally we do find that even important and newsworthy developments do not merit place on the front page, and are rather buried in the inside pages. The cardinal principle of journalism is to present fair, objective, accurate, and balanced information to the reader and viewer without journalists assuming the role of the gatekeepers. Information should be pure, should be original. And there is a saying that information with confirmation is more than an ammunition. That is the value of information. Fortunately for us, there are a number of journalists who follow these principles still, like some politicians also following principles. Doctors also treating their profession as a mission, lifelong mission. And that is what makes the Indian media so credible and unshackled by constraints. However, there are aberrations like in any system. It is one thing to provide an insightful analysis of a news development by substantiating it with facts and figures, and another thing to build a story on conjecture. The essential challenge is when this trend tends to become a new normal. Under no circumstances can slanted and opinionated reporting be termed as interpretive reporting. Perhaps it would be appropriate here to recall the views of Mahatma Gandhi on newspapers. He said, I quote, "One of the objectives of a newspaper is to understand popular feeling and to give expression to it. Another is to arouse among the people certain desirable sentiments, and the third is fearlessly to expose popular defects," unquote. Instead of giving expression to popular feeling, some newspapers these days are giving expression to colored and partisan views. For instance, reading any one major newspaper in the past used to give fairly good understanding of what was happening around the country and the world. Nowadays, I read around 18 newspapers. I am slowly reducing. Of course, earlier I was in public life, so I have to read, act, and react from time to time. I was also holding the responsibility of information and broadcasting minister for some time, and also was in the government and the party. So I used to read and then also formulate my views and then respond to the criticism or try to project the view of the party. But today, if you read one newspaper, you will not get full picture, even two or three or four. Because if you, I just suggest to all of you, you read two newspapers about the same incident. One newspaper says massive response. The other newspaper says all empty chairs with photo, information with confirmation. The photo might have been taken before the starting of the meeting also. It is happening. I'm not just joking. The reason is political parties started their own newspapers. They also call them as newspapers. There should be newsletters. Politicians started their own newspapers to project and protect and cover their own this thing. And individuals also started channels to protect and promote their business. That is an undesirable trend that has crept in into our system, and by and large it has become an accepted norm. This is an unfortunate state of affairs. To protect your business interest, to promote your business interest, to propagate your business interest, or to paint your rival in a negative manner, you are using this institution. I'm not mentioning any particular district. I'm just making a general comment of what is happening. And also, as some people cannot do any service or do something to win the confidence of the people, they project through their own newspaper. You have your own channel and you can have your own news. Ultimately, you only have to view it. I don't think people will give that much credence, because the moment they understand, oh yeah, unka hai na, theek hai, aise hoga. This is slowly is developing in our country. The one will have to read a minimum of 4 to 5 newspapers to get a complete sense of current developments. Same is the case with the news channels also. Now we have more than 1,000 channels. 1,000, by this time, like our Indian population, this population also might have gone up. Making news, breaking news, good news, bad news, nahi khud unka news aur ek dusre ke khilaf news unka hi aapas mein. This is the trend today. This is the trend that is happening. Time and again, I have urged the media to not color news with views. I am not against newspapers coming in colors, presenting the news in a colored manner. That's the problem. And I always stress the need to maintain objectivity, fairness, and accuracy. The neutrality and sanctity of newsrooms should be upheld at all times. This has become all the more critical in present times after the advent of fake news phenomena and the huge impact the social media is creating. With the electronic and social media providing news by minute, with alerts and flashes on smartphones, journalists will have to exercise greater caution and guard against fake news, disinformation and misinformation. Sensationalism has become the order of the day. Sensational news means senseless news. That you realize once you come into senses. This is the order of the day. Even well-meaning, some of the channels also are tempted, because others are doing, if you don't compete, you will be lagging behind and all. This sort of competition. With business groups and even political parties and personalities, setting up newspapers and TV channels used to further their interest, the core values of journalism are getting eroded. You may ask me, sir, do the political parties have no right to start a paper? Yes, it should be written. But this is a newspaper belonging to so-and-so political party. It may look a little odd for some of you, but I have no hesitation in saying so. without delving further into the reasons for the present state of affairs, I would like journalist bodies like yours to do a serious introspection. In such a context, freedom and responsibility of the media acquire far greater significance than ever before. Freedom and responsibility cannot be considered as inseparable and are interdependent on each other. The media has the onerous responsibility to not only provide unadulterated and correct information, but also educate the people on their rights as well. I will just give you an example, share an example. In 1984, August, late Sri N.T. Ramarao was dethroned by the governor, though he had a majority. So all the political parties, opposition parties, I was also a member there at the time, joined together in the name of protecting democracy, though we were from different parties. And there was an agitation. And finally, at the end of the day, we thought that we should present the strength of Sri N.T. Ramarao before the Rashtrapati, so that the entire country will know, and there will be pressure on the powers that be to install him back as the chief minister. So that of there is a big story. I don't want to get into that. That's not relevant for today. But the final point I want to place before you is, we came here, 164 MLS, 294 is the strength of the Andhra Pradesh Assembly, then Andhra Pradesh Assembly, combined state. So 164 is majority. 164 people are supporting him, so he has got majority that way. So we went to Rashtrapati Bhavan, and we met Rashtrapati. At the time, Sri Gnani Jail Singh was Rashtrapati. He received us, heard us, and offered some coffee and other things. And then we thanked him for giving that opportunity, because there was pressure on him not to meet us also. Our trains were delayed, coming to Delhi and all. So when I was coming out, the ADC to President of India, he called me aside and told me, Mr. Naidu, see this. Those days, the facilities were, transmissional facilities were very less. So there was one telex mission, I think telex, in those days used to call, in Rashtrapati Bhavan. He just took me to that. What I saw in that report was stunning. The report says 18 of the MLAs who are supposed to be in Delhi meeting the President of India are paraded before the governor in Hyderabad, same time. We were surprised. I couldn't believe that news. So then I rang up one of the newspaper editor. He said, yes. Then, of course, then we got an idea. We separated those 18 MLAs whose names we have collected from one of the editors of the newspaper from Hyderabad, and then organized. And then I suggested that we should have a photo in front of Rashtrapati Bhavan. The photographer was not there. The cell phones were not there at the time. So we don't know what to do and all. So then I rang up Advaniji, and I told him, sir, this is the situation. So Advaniji sent one photographer, but one of the senior photographer, I think his name is Raghu Roy. So he came and then took a, Ramarauji was sitting, he was carrying stick and he was in that saffron dress at the time. So all these 18 MLAs were separated, photographers taken. There was no photo fax also those days. So then we requested one person go to Hyderabad along with this photo and then release it to media. He said, how do you go? Those days you don't have this many number of flights and all. So finally somebody has rushed you to airport and then requested one of the passenger to opt out and then substitute him with N.T. Ramarao's son who was there. And then he went and we made a request to two leading newspapers, one is the Indian Express in English and Eenadu in Telugu, to delay their edition. And this photo has reached. Next day, I am just giving you the information with confirmation. It is more than nomination. The next day, Asali Delhi me, Nakili Hyderabad Rajbhavan me. That was the story. The original are in Delhi. The duplicate are being paraded here. So the truth has come out. That's the power of the media. Because media power means one is the credibility, second is the photo. The photo speaks for itself. Kaam bolta hai aisa hai na ek, like that. So the journalist community and the media should always keep in mind the need to give correct picture, accurate information, truth, particularly at times of crisis, at times of challenges. This becomes all the more relevant. It should also be remembered freedom of media is not absolute and is circumscribed by certain reasonable restrictions relating to security of state, public order, decency or morality, defamation and contempt of court, and sovereignty and integrity of India. There are enough provisions in our own, legal to take care if somebody is erring. But it takes process and all. But that's why I was suggesting that media houses, journalist unions, they must have a self-code of conduct to see that we adhere to these core principles of journalism, of wedding to truth. We have to be a true champion of the underdog. It has to be in the vanguard of fighting the ills that are plaguing the society. This is also a responsibility. Discrimination on the basis of religion, discrimination on the basis of caste, discrimination on the basis of gender. The media should be in the forefront to highlight, to condemn such activities so that the society gets alerted and the wrongdoers, they also get frightened and the people in general are guided properly. This is the duty of the media also. And I can go a step further and suggest Fitness India or the Swachh Bharat, Beti Bachao, Beti Padao, Park, Drop Crop, or Yoga. These are all the issues of public importance. Which government does it, which leader else does it, that should not be a matter. Yoga is now catching up worldwide. I have been to Costa Rica 2 months back and I found the Costa Rica president, who is only 38 years old, he issued a presidential decree. The Romanian president was telling me, took me to the central hall and said, Mr. Naidu, here we had a yoga day, June 21st. Every country is now trying to follow it. We should also promote. And I'm happy that the media is promoting Swachh Bharat, encouraging Clean India campaign and all. So this should not be seen from a partisan angle. That's why I tell the youngsters, my yoga is for your body, not for Modi. Understand this. Modi is the Prime Minister, of course. Prime Minister is Prime Minister. These are all programs. Cleanliness is for your own. So that should be, these should become societal movements. And isko ek janandolan ka roop dena chahiye to isme media ka bhi kartavya hai, dayatva banta hai. This is my appeal to the media. Some of them are doing a great job, including English language newspapers also, and also even the electronic media. Some of them has taken it as a campaign, some of the houses. I compliment them. And I suggest to others also to take up such programs and then promote social harmony, national integration, and also remind the people of societal responsibility. Because mere legislation alone cannot bring the desired change. In a vast country like India, which is having 130 crore population, with 760 speaking languages, different religions, different this thing and all, you need somebody to promote, somebody to propagate, somebody to counsel, somebody to educate, somebody to remind from time to time. And media is the best communication in that regard. to take up these challenges. And wherever the media is involved and wherever the public are involved, those movements are becoming successful. So this is my appeal on the press day to the media friends. Please take this as a mission. The investigative journalism that uncovered the Watergate scandal and the subsequent downfall of an American president is still fresh in our memory. I don't want to quote Indian instances because it will be political and all. And fortunately, now I'm out of politics. I don't belong to Prakash Javadekar party. I left it. But I'm only retired from politics, but not tired in public life. That's why I'm still going around the country, meeting the people, greeting the people, talking with the people, walking with the people, spending the time with the people, and trying to interact with the people. We have, there are many instances in which the media and the, of late, the social media played a critical role. Take the example of Egyptian uprising some years ago. We have seen the positive impact created by the media in promoting campaign for a clean India. Thus, I feel that the press, TV, and even the social media must educate the people on important health issues such as lifestyle changes and growing tendencies of non-communicable diseases. This is a friend, another subject which is dearer to my heart, is about this fast-changing lifestyle. We have to educate, we have to alert our children the evil effect of the change of lifestyle and all. No physical activity at all, literally. That is killing our generation. There has to be, PM has to give a call for Fitness India and all. Fitness India, that's an issue to be taken up by all of us, lifestyle changes. One must live and love with the nature. Nature, culture, together for a better future. So nature is very important. We are ignoring it at our own peril. And nature is showing its fury on us. The second one is of the food habits. Don't worry, I am not going to prescribe any food code or anything. Eat any food you like. Both vegetarian, non-vegetarian, are together also, no problem that way. But please remember the food that has been prescribed by our forefathers for years and thousands of years of civilization and experience. According to season, according to reason, according to atmosphere, they have prescribed some food, cooked food properly, cooked food. We must, the reason is why I'm saying this is I have taken it as a mission. Everywhere I'm going, I'm mentioning this one and another one. Another one, I will come to that. This is about eating proper food, protein food. All of us may think, no, we're all very healthy, sir. Go to doctor, then you'll come to know our health. What is missing in our body? What is lacking in our body? D3 deficiency, B12 deficiency, then later you realize. Physically, we are not that much strong. Yesterday, a doctor was telling me, sir, I was trying to walk at 12 o'clock because sun has come and all. Sun, not my sun, our sun. The doctor came running because there are two doctors are there in my house regularly watching me. Even here also, they're there. Protocol-wise, they have to take care of. No, sir. The air quality is very bad. Please, please. And that to now you are above 60. Our resistance power is getting reduced. One is, of course, climate change. The second one is the food habits. And children are being tempted to Western food. Western food is suitable to Western people. For them, that is best. For us, that's not. The pizza, the burger, the other. People say, sir, one boy told me, no, sir, nowadays food is instant, sir. Instant food means constant disease. You have to understand that. How can the food be instant? Food has to be cooked, na? And there is no dearth of opportunities in India. Thousands of restaurants and thousands of types of food are available in our country, in different parts. Beautiful food is available to you. Very tasty food also. I am a foodie till the other day, along with late Sri Arun Jetri and late Anant Kumar. Any new restaurant means you can find three of us. We used to find three of us there. Unfortunately, both of them are no more. But recently I started changing my food habits also because doctors have told me, sir, you have eaten enough for life. So now regulate, minimize. The food, go through all the international magazines. The international magazines, including American magazines, are suggesting that non-communicable diseases are increasing because of the food habits and lifestyles. They are anonymous on this. The cancer, the diabetic, the other. So I suggest the media also to educate the younger generation, our children, our future, about proper lifestyle and also about proper food. I'm happy some of the newspapers gives importance to nature, separate column. Some of them they give importance to sports. Some of them they give importance to literature. Some of them give importance to various aspects, ecological problems, and also food items also, and also women's, all these things, different papers. That's good. I appreciate them because every section needs a proper guidance. Another thing I want everybody to focus is, I know that I am before an audience of mostly English-speaking people. I feel that everybody must protect, promote, propagate their mother tongue. Because bhasha and bhavana eksa chalta hai. Then I am not against English. I am in favor of learning English, even French, even Chinese. You need more languages, understand, learn more languages. But first promote and propagate your language, you will be able to understand better and articulate better. Fortunately, in our country, even the, I don't want to call it as regional media, there is media in language newspapers across the country, they are also gaining strength. That is also a thing to be encouraged. And children should be told about the importance of the language and also about preserving, promoting our culture. Share and care is the core of Indian philosophy. And that philosophy has to be protected. Of course, my dear friends, the mobile phones are revolutionizing the manner in which we share data, information and visuals. With the number of smartphone users crossing 450 million in the country, every smartphone user has become a potential journalist. In fact, there are many instances where smartphone users have become citizen journalists and virtually provided breaking news alerts to TV channels. No doubt the internet and mobile telephony have been democratized the availability of information. However, the glut of information is also generating fake news, fake narratives. Journalists must guard against such news and fake narratives as they can be used by vested interests to create dissensions and divisions in our pluralistic society. Apart from enforcing self-regulation, the media must ensure that the core values of accuracy, fairness, objectivity, newsworthiness, and independence are never compromised. Instead of focusing on negativity, it is important for the newspapers in a country like India to accord importance to developmental journalism. Developmental journalism. Development is the news. There is a hunger for development among the people because the world is open. Unfortunately, we have a generation, 65% of our Indian population is below 35 years. It's a great demographic dividend, but also a challenge. Their aspirations are very high. So we must really guide this younger generation. Maybe the time has come for media bodies to come out, as I told you, with a code of conduct in view of the critical role journalism plays in protecting democracy and serving the larger good of society. We should strengthen this important fourth pillar by ensuring truth is never compromised. Truth is never compromised. That has to be kept in mind by each and every person. And the last point I would like to focus is about the disinformation and misinformation about India. We, the Indian press, must protect the interests of India, promote the interests of the country, propagate the values and virtues of our system. We are the largest democracy in the world, parliamentary democracy, functional democracy. I don't think there is any equivalent to this at this level of population which has regular elections. And we are the country which really upholds the secular principles. Secularism is subsequent, na? Sarva dharma samabhavana is part of our culture. As I told you just now, Vasudeva Kutumbakam is our basic philosophy. And the third thing is that the minorities are protected well in this country than any other country in the world. And some countries who do not respect secularism, who do not respect other minorities, they are trying to give us pravachans. I don't want to name, you know, many of the countries. Many, not what they are doing and all. And then we are a country which protected democratic rights. And we are a country where you have liberty. You have liberty to attack the Prime Minister. Write about the Prime Minister. I saw some time back, example, one of the leading newspapers, Pink, not the name, color. An article was written by a very famous this thing. If Narendra Modi, the Prime Minister, dies, maybe, I don't know whether it was his wish or just I see, the next man will be this. The next man will be there. That. So please, people who have brought their mobiles, can you keep them in silence mode? मैं अनुरोध करता हूँ जो बगल में बैठे हैं लोग कृपया उनको मदद करिए कारण क्या है कुछ लोगों को ऑन करना मालूम है मगर ऑफ करना मालूम नहीं तो ये तो कमजोरी है दिस इज अ वीकनेस एंड आई फाइंड इट हैपनिंग इन नंबर ऑफ दैट्स व्हाई आवर प्रोटोकॉल पीपल से सर इन वाइस प्रेसिडेंट प्रेसिडेंट्स मीटिंग ऑल फोन शुड बी टेकन आउट एंड देन कैप्ट समवेयर आई सेड भाई ये झंझट में क्यों पड़ते हैं किसका फ़ोन कहाँ है कैसा मालूम नहीं ना वो सब उसको सेपरेट आइडेंटिफाई करना रखना वगैरह कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं कुछ होने वाले दे से इट मोर ऑन सिक्योरिटी एस्पेक्ट एंड ऑन नथिंग टू वरी ऑन दैट काउंट सिक्योरिटी इज नो प्रॉब्लम बट ओनली थिंग इज अबाउट द नॉइस इफ देयर इज मोर नॉइस द वॉइस विल बी लॉस्ट दैट्स अ प्रॉब्लम सो प्लीज ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड इट एंड देन द एंड आवर कंट्री वॉट एवर वी डू वॉट आई कैन प्राउडली से वॉट एवर वी डू इट इन अ डेमोक्रेटिक मैनर एंड हाउ some people, even about Article 370. Article 370, because I am also connected, that's why I'm mentioning it specially. Article 370 is part of our constitution, but it was not brought as a constitutional amendment. Many people not even aware of it at that time. It was not part of accession agreement between Maharaja and our government. It was a subsequent addition. And while making that addition also, it was written, it will be temporary, transitory. Some people are trying to give temporary means some 500 years or 1,000 years, that interpretation they are giving. But according to our understanding, with our knowledge, temporary means temporary. Temporary. 72 years, the parliament in its corrective wisdom, seeing the mood of the people, have discussed it, approved it. I am the chairman of the Rajya Sabha, the upper house, where the government do not have a majority. The government has brought that bill in Rajya Sabha. I was wondering, they should have brought it in Lok Sabha, they brought it in Rajya Sabha. And then in Rajya Sabha, after thorough discussion, I have almost exhausted all the speakers. People were sending slips to me. Sir, please allow, my party time is over. Please allow me at least 4 minutes, 5 minutes. I said, why 5 minutes? Take 7 minutes. I allowed them all. It happened. You can see on record. And everybody, all have been allowed to speak. They made their points, counterpoints. And then at the end of the day, except two people who tore the constitution in the house, I did not take any action against any member. I never wanted to take such action. I never wanted to repeat instances where Parliament was closed and telecast was stopped and all. I never wanted it to happen. And I am the chairman, I am frank with you. I never wanted that. I wanted a debate. Debate has taken place. And after the debate, the Parliament, Rajya Sabha, has approved it with 2/3 majority. And Lok Sabha has approved it 4/5 majority. Because the government has majority there. And also majority of the parties. It was temporary. In 63, Jawaharlal Nehruji himself assured, Gurujari Nanda said, 10 days or maybe 10 months, it's going. Why do you worry? Because a lot of MPs, they gave a notice and they were discussing within the house that this temporary provision should go. This is under court. And I was quoting Hindustan Times, there was a report about the number of MPs giving a notice and discussing. And I was quoting that paper in Chennai. Mr. N. Ram sent me Hindu newspaper cutting. This is 64, Hindustan Times. He sent a cutting of 63 of Hindu, where this was mentioned, it is going to be temporary and it will go anyhow down. So that is the background. And how so much negative propaganda being carried out by enemies of the nation and also by people who do not have correct information. And there is also another misconception. Jammu Kashmir means it is a state, okay? And Jammu Kashmir means some people think only Kashmir Valley. No, Kashmir Valley is 15%. Jammu is 26%. Ladakh is 59% area wise. But the picture is the moment you mentioned that only, no, it should be total, viewed it in totality and it has to be understood and all. And even the other day, the American Congress, they should focus more about their internal happenings. Yesterday, some children fired at elders, elders fired at children, and then social discrimination, firing on blacks or others and all. These things are happening. It's unfortunate. We don't want to get into their internal affairs. Instead of focusing on that, they are discussing about India, about, oh, fine, no problem. But you must hear all the views. Today, there is a report, Sunanda Vasist, Kashmiri Pandit turned writer, put up a spirited defense. Sunanda ji said, she turned out to be best India's defense at the hearing. And she said that you don't know the real picture and it's all lopsided here. Its lopsided nature of panel witnesses appear to have hit home. A senior member of the commission who has been accused of calling a second hearing in a short period of time. This is the second hearing. And then they go on bashing India being influenced by the propaganda of our neighbor, aiding, abetting, funding, training terrorism. Terrorism is enemy of humanity. So the media should create awareness among the people about the dangers of terrorism, and particularly, and some people are trying to mix terror with religion to cover up their heinous crimes. No religion propagates or protects terrorism. No religion. You can take it for granted, go through texts of any religion. But some people are trying to take cover to justify their heinous crimes. And we want to friendly relations. Before I conclude, I would like to stress on this point. We want to have friendly relations with all countries, including with our neighbor. Because late Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee said, you can't change your friends, you can't change your neighbor. So we want to be friendly with that neighbor, provided if the neighbor changes his attitude, his or her attitude, of not to interfere our internal affairs. And nobody in our country should do anything which will weaken the cause. And these people who are discussing about it, why are not they discussing about the Pakistanis' continuous interference in the internal affairs of our country by aiding, abetting, funding, training terrorists? Who is behind all these violent incidents? Who is inspiring Jaish-e-Mohammed? Who is inspiring Lashkar-e-Toyba? Who is inspiring all these other organizations? But the focus, the Western media somehow, and what is happening in Afghanistan? What is happening in Balochistan? What is happening in the Pakistani occupied Kashmir? The massacre that's going on? The discrimination that's being mooted out to people? So I appeal to the Indian journalists and media fraternity, please keep the correctness of things in mind and also rise to the occasion of protecting India's national interest. One can have a difference of opinion on issues. You've got every right, and you can write about it, you can agitate about it, you can protect also, you can protest also. All these rights are guaranteed by our constitution and it's very much available. And the Indian media can play a very constructive role as far as this national larger interest is concerned. That has to be kept in mind while pursuing our own. You can criticize any political party, support any political party on the basis of merits of the issue. That is always open and there is no restriction to my knowledge about the promoting truth or taking up or championing the cause of the people, etc. My dear friends, I thought I should share some of my thoughts with you today on this important occasion of Press Day. I compliment the Press Council of India for its role in promoting responsible journalism in the country, and the government is duty bound to see that there is a level playing field provided to all in the field of journalism and genuine newspapers, particularly small newspapers, are need to be encouraged, and with a little more weightage to the national language newspapers. I have no problem on that. As I told you, I am not against any other this thing, but the people understand and it reaches easily to the people. That has to be given a little more weightage, while learning, reading English is also required. But at the same time, we should not ignore our native languages. This is the appeal I have. I would like to thank the Chairman Press Council of India and the Minister, Sri Prakashji Javadekar, for providing me this good opportunity to be present here and to be part of felicitation to some of the great journalists, including photojournalists of this country. And I would like to thank all of you for giving me a very patient hearing. Thank you.